Well, it's lovely. I mean, you know, W1A grew out of 2012, which itself was a labour of love. It was a slow burner and gradually found its audience. And, you know, we've only done 4 episodes of W1A, and we've done just recently shot some more, and it had a lovely reaction. And, yes, it does poke fun a bit at the idiocies that we get ourselves into in our broadcasting industry, but mainly it's about the bonkers nature of committees and management structure and people saying they'll do things when actually, you know, they haven't got a, you know, shadows helping hope in hell of actually achieving it. So Ian Fletcher, my character, is at the centre of this, trying to keep calm in a storm of chaos. But I think that's why audiences recognise it. It is set against the backdrop of the media, but really it's about any committee, be it well, any functioning sort of organisation, be it a FTSE 100 or a church hall committee.
How surprised have you been by how accommodating the BBC have been about the series?
We've been absolutely staggered by how accommodating the BBC have been. They haven't asked to see scripts or anything, so they've given us free rein, or John Morton, who writes it. And John himself, you know, he's a bit of a hermit, doesn't get out much, but he does have this uncanny ear for the absurdities of everyday language, that where we say so much without actually communicating, a bit like I'm doing now. And so they've been remarkable. They've been remarkable at letting us, you know, use their offices. So it's a cheap set for them, since they're paying for it. And all the staff have been wonderfully accommodating as well. And they keep coming up and sort of saying, you don't know the half of it.
Talking about surreal experiences, obviously you've just had the royal visit at Ealing Studios. What was that like? I mean, obviously a very special moment for the studio and for you personally, I'd imagine.
Oh, it was. It was a great tonic yesterday to have had Her Royal Highness come and visit. Ealing Studios has been around functioning for over 100 years, and to have her come and have a little look around backstage at where we you know put a lot of the show on was great for all of us. And of course, you know, I am her favourite character, so that was even better. But then she said that to all the cast, which was interesting.
Obviously exciting to have a new face on set, but is it strange for you now having lost so many of our familiar faces on Downton?
Well, you know, there's always room for new faces. You know, we've had some wonderful guest artists from Shirley MacLaine to Paul Giamatti, Richard E. Grant, and it's great that actors of their calibre want to come and play with us. When we've lost some of the regular characters, like Dan Stevens' character, Matthew Crawley, or my dear darling, late lamented daughter, Jessica Brown Finley, you know, they're still great pals of the show, but even though they've gone on to other things. So we're still a tight team, and you know, you never know. There might be the odd face popping up again that you've seen before.
And of course, I mean, the show keeps on marching on through time. How's that going to affect the cast? I mean, obviously, because I mean, particularly last season, we saw your character, Lord Grantham, really start to soften in some way.
Well, Robert ebbs and flows. You know, sometimes he seems to be a bit of a dinosaur, but then he'll often do something that's quite, you know, liberal and good-hearted and saves the day in terms of his own character. And this year's no exception. You know, you think he's put up a brick wall, but actually he's climbing it at the same time.
What do you think the magic of Downton is? Why do you think people in every corner of the globe seem to relate to it?
Oh, I've no idea why if we all knew the answer to that, we'd bottle it and become millionaires. But I think it's possibly as simple as engaging characters and storylines where you want to know what happens next. So, and if you get bored of one character, there's another one along in 28 seconds. So, you know, it's a fast-moving but classical show. It seems to have hit the spot, and what can I say? We're thrilled that it continues to do so.
Before you leave us, do you have a message for Downton fans?
Keep watching. We're just filming season 6 at the moment, and it's going to be the best yet, I think.
My name's Andrew Buchan, and I'm here representing the Honourable Woman.
Andrew, it's fantastic to have you here with us at the Broadcasting Press Guild Awards. What do these awards in particular mean to you? What makes them special?
They're a very prestigious event, and I think they're probably one of the first events of the year as well, so it's exciting on both of those counts. But it's just nice to be nominated in any kind of field, really, but we're all very excited to be here. The thing that made me want to be a part of it was just purely and simply the script. I hadn't read a script quite like it in a very, very, very long time. And I'm not sure I will for years to come. I don't know. There's just something about it that was just there's something of a bit of a masterpiece in there. And then on top of that, the part of Ephra Stein, was just this hugely complex individual and a challenge to play, which is always what you look for in any character. And why the audience responded to it, I don't know. I think the cast were exceptional. I think Maggie was off the scale. All of the cast were just beautiful to work with. And Hugo, the director, was amazing. And I think the production values on it were quite good. And so, yeah, hopefully they responded to all that. But it was a very interesting story, I think, which a lot of people have actually said they needed to watch each episode twice in order to fathom exactly what was going on.
You mentioned that your character was quite complex. What do you think he brought to the tapestry of the show? What was the essence of the character for you?
Well, he was just quite a quiet, understated chap, often kind of lurking in the shadows behind all the action, but unbeknownst to most people, pulling quite a few strings back there in the shadows. And so, I don't know, there was a subtlety to him and a darkness and just a vulnerability that you know, is always interesting to play. And just a multifaceted individual, which, credit to Hugo, he wrote so beautifully.
Of course, I mean, you mentioned the astonishing cast. Can you talk particularly about Maggie and what makes her such a special performer?
Special in my eyes, because, rightly or wrongly, you'd kind of forgive someone coming over from Hollywood and not quite fitting into the BBC Two kind of way of things, because it must be very, very different, I would imagine. But there was none of that. She slipped straight in, no airs and graces, just gave herself wholly and entirely to the project from minute one, and was just an absolute dream to work with. And she kind of set the bar for everyone. Just very generous in the way she did the scenes, and challenged herself, and just attacked every single scene. There was never any kind of letting up with Maggie. She really did give it every single drop of sweat she had. Favourite moments in The Honourable Woman? Thousands. That's a tricky one. Too many to mention, really. I can't. I mean, looking back, it's such a kind of dense tapestry of shots, so it's hard to single one out. I enjoyed the entire thing. It was a pleasure to be part of.
Gogglebox, a huge success with critics and fans alike. Why do you think people have latched onto the show so much?
Well, at first, I think people were quite sceptical. In fact, before the show went on air, there were a lot of people on Twitter saying, a show about people watching television? This must be the end of Western civilization. But then they saw it, and they realized that this was actually rather entertaining, because there's a great cast, and it's the same collection of households each week, so people get to know them. And the team that make the show are very talented, and they bring out the humour of our cast as they respond to what they see on television. And because it's made so quickly, it's made within the week, it feels like a way of catching the nation's conversation that week, whether it's talking about what's going on in the news, or what's happening in the big entertainment shows, or what's happening in some quirky documentary that happened that week. Well, I think that I'm struck week after week about how smart our cast are. It's so hard for so easy actually for television professionals or politicians to think that they can fool the audience. But every week our audience sees through those things where they think that they're being manipulated, and they spot it, and they're very articulate about that. And I think it shows that you can't think you can easily fool the audience, because they'll spot you. Well, Gogglebox is getting more and more popular. It's the latest series that's on Channel 4 at the moment is significantly more popular than the previous. So we hope to be making the show for a long while yet. I think the challenge for us is to find new families to keep it fresh, but at the same time to hold on to the people that, you know, our audience has fallen in love with, because we've got an amazing cast of characters, and long may they carry on doing it.
I mean, it's thrilling. What's particularly good about this award is you don't have any of the tension of having to sit there and pretend to smile when you lose. You know, it's all very, very chilled out and relaxed. It's boring to say, but it is true that, you know, most projects, any award you win as an actor, it's usually to do with the community of actors that you've been working with. And this was an amazing group of actors. that were around me, or we were around each other. So I'm very happy for all of us that, you know, it's been recognised. Not just me, but Pete's script, which is extraordinary.
What was it about the script that made you immediately recognise that it was something special?
That it's totally unlike any other script I've ever read. That it seemed to... That it breaks itself up with these titles, that it's funny and sad, that you think something terrible's going to happen and bad things do happen, but not really as terrible as you think they're going to happen. Plays with your expectations in that way. And in some way unites the audience with people that they normally feel separate from.
How much fun is it to play a character that is as relentlessly upbeat as yours in this?
That's a good question. It's good, it's funny. I mean, I think that often that can seem comic. And I suppose the challenge is to make it authentic rather than just a comic character. He's not just a comic character, he's a very serious character, you know. Well, it's a bit of a cliche now that TV, certainly in terms of development, the kind of scripts that are coming through TV now, the different formats of TV, mean that so there's a very wide range of projects. I mean, it's a great testament to the BBC that they produce something like Marvellous, which is so unusual. It's such an unusual structure as a script. And I think TV in general is moving that way. And even some of the Detectorists, it's very quiet comedy. It's almost so quiet, it turns into drama at times.
One question Marvel fans have, we sort of saw you finally killed off in Captain America the Winter Soldier, yeah. But of course in the original comics your character lives on. Is that something that we may see in the Marvel Cinema Universe as well?
Well, of course I'm contractually obliged to not let on about that, but I mean he has a sort of virtual existence which would suggest that he could pop up anywhere. And I don't think I'm, you know, Agent Carter, my character showed up in retrospect at the end of Agent Carter. So I think that, like a lot of characters in what they call the Marvel Universe, is there's a kind of ricochet between the different films. Not just the main characters, but also characters like mine, who have the liberty to sort of license to pop out all over the place. And I mean, I think that's really fun as a fan of that kind of film. I mean, it's really extraordinary the way that the writers can keep all that in their heads, you know. The whole Marvel project, and it was outlined to me a few years ago, so it's always been their plan, is to sort of build, like the comics, this sort of very dense, you know, cross-referencing of, like a mythology, you know, like a huge mythology with all these different characters. And Agent Carter's just one part of that, in a way. It's another strand. You sort of see the liberty that they have with it now. Well, on the one level, you know, acting's very straightforward. It's knowing why what your character's doing, where they've come from, what they want. But I suppose in a big franchise movie, you might have... They tend to be shorter scenes, which take longer to shoot. So there's an issue of concentration and stuff like that. Whereas in something like Marvelous, it's a much quicker turnover. It's more like an independent film. So they are similar but very different. They're almost like two different industries.
Particularly the younger generation, who are you most impressed by?
Well, Jennifer Lawrence is a pretty impressive actress because she wears a huge amount of pressure very lightly. And she doesn't seem perturbed by a lot of the pressures that beset other actresses of her status. So, but she's great, you know, absolutely great. Well, actually, the second series of Detectorists is coming up, and then a couple of things that may or may not happen between now and then.
What can fans expect from the second season? Obviously, the first season, a huge hit. Does the second season continue in a similar fashion?
Don't know. That's all under wraps.
I'm here with Crack and Ori, which is a fantastic series. I remember as a child watching Jack and Ori because my mum used to read stories on Jack and Ori. I really remember The Ordinary Princess by MMK and these beautiful illustrations. And so then when I'm such a genius idea doing it for adults. Krakenori, much darker. The story that I read is called Murder, He Wrote, about a man who attempts to frame his wife for his own murder, by Niko Tatarovic. And it's a really great series. I think people have really liked it. That they've got great other readers. Rick Mail, Vic Reeves, Warwick Davis, Mira Sayal, lots of people. Johnny Vegas. And so it's lovely to be here today celebrating the success of Krakenori amongst other brilliant programmes.
We've loved watching you on Mission Survive with your cousin. Yes. Have you been watching it?
I've seen a little bit of it, yes.
What's it like watching it back?
It's really interesting because it's such a small bit of what we actually went through in the whole journey. So, and happy memories of a really great team that I was with, and with Lawrence as well. So, and we sort of we're very sort of closely bonded on that show.
Learned about yourself while you were out there and doing all those grueling missions?
Yes, well, interestingly, we were told that we didn't have to be physically fit when we went on the show, and you really did have to be physically fit. So I was quite pleased. I was a bit fitter than I thought I was just surviving, because you were on the move from sort of, you know, the crack of dawn until, you know, making the camp at night. And also just that you can do those things. That's what I think is interesting about the show, is that, you know, when you are asked to eat a live scorpion or mealworms, you didn't see that last week, but we actually ate live mealworms and things like that. You sort of think that you can't, all drinking your own wee at home, sitting on the sofa, you think, I couldn't do that, but actually you could do it. And that's, I think, the good thing about the show, is it shows you that if you were really in a survival situation, you would do it. Well, I didn't spend a lot of time with him, actually. I'd read, I think he's a fantastic presenter, and I think he's extremely talented with what he did. And so I'd read all his books before I went on the show, his extreme food book, his children's books, True Grit, the book which has been held out. That's a very, very clever edit on that show, because in fact that book was, I'd read it and it was completely waterlogged and destroyed, and so it was a point, our bags were so heavy, they were in water every day, so anything you could get rid of along the way you got rid of. Anyway, that's television. You know, Bear and I are exactly the same age, so it's quite interesting our different philosophies in life, I think.
Well, it was amazing. First of all, we were all in Liverpool for like 8 weeks, which you can imagine was amazing, and everyone was so supportive, all the locals, and like we were shooting in this row of terraced houses one night. It was a night shoot, and everyone was going, come in, girl, come in for a cup of tea, and everyone was just in every single house down the whole street. So it was just a really brilliant experience, and the whole team worked so hard to recreate that era and that amazing 60s Mersey beat sound and vibe, and singing live on set. Whoever's idea that was that yours? It was, yeah, genius. No, Paul? Yeah. With Jeff Pope, the writer, and Paul Whittington, director, decided that we should sing it all live, which was terrifying, but also really good fun, because you really got that vibe of what it must have been like to be singing in the cavern with the Beatles, and we had real musicians, and so it was just so different to anything I've done before, so I absolutely loved it.
Of course, I mean, Scylla's life, so full of dramatic and magical moments. Is there a particular series that was moment that was most surreal for you to be recreating?
Well, lots of the singing moments were, but what I love about that story was Scylla and Bobby's relationship. It's a real love story, and I mean, I don't know any other story like it, where they kind of met as two little kind of scallies, you know, running around the streets, and him driving her in a biscuit van to gigs, you know, to then going to the States, and he became her manager, and they were just, you know, each other's rock, you know, and I thought that was a beautiful story that Jeff captured perfectly.
Of course, there's so much responsibility playing someone's real life. What response did you have from Scylla, and how much did it mean to you when she gave you a feedback?
I was so nervous when I met Scylla. I brought her a big bouquet of flowers, and I was kind of shaking and wanting to curtsy. But she was so lovely, and we went out for dinner, and Paul O'Grady came along, because he's a mutual friend. So you can imagine, like, he was kind of making us laugh lots and breaking the ice. But she was really supportive from the start. I mean, I know when Jeff was writing it, she was nervous at first, but then she totally gave us her blessing and was really supportive, and then at the end sent me a lovely bouquet of flowers, so I'm hopefully she enjoyed it, but yeah, she was really supportive.
Well, I think I love that era. I love the connection with those iconic moments, the Beatles, Brian Epstein, but really at its heart, as Sheridan has said, it's a love story. You know, the fact that there's a young girl, a young boy, dirt poor, I mean, don't mean to be insulting, but that's really, they didn't really have two pennies to rub together, either family, and they came together and built something amazing. But it was built on love, and that's really, I'm sort of a sucker for those kinds of stories, and I just enjoyed playing with those moments from the past, and just, you know, the sounds and the voices, and then Sheridan and the cast brought it all to life.
We're seeing a lot of success for special mini-series here at the awards today. Do you think they give you opportunities that perhaps don't get from features?
Yeah, I do. I think the longer form helps. I mean, I think that it's much, much more satisfying, the three episodes that we were able to work with on Scylla. And I also think that it's an outlet for, you know, the rump of the British film industry, really. You know, the chance to make things with big budget and with proper stories. And you're not ensnared in the kind of returning series situation. You know, you're not kind of thinking, what are we going to do with season two, season three? So for filmmakers, they're great miniseries. I think that form's brilliant. But, I understand the need for a returning series, but it's great that the big channels still back them. Really, what worked about the films we made was that people didn't know about it. And they kind of do know about the second half. Mm. We sort of do know about Blind Date because, you know, we all grew up with it. And as you say, you know, the other thing that I had a real ambition for was a performance piece. That's where the whole thing of asking Sheridan and the other artists to perform live on set, because it was the thrill of watching, you know, you could imagine it. The set was an exact recreation of the Cavern Club, and Sheridan sang, and you know, she wasn't trying to impersonate Scylla, but she, you know, the red hair and the look, and then, you know, she was into the part, and that's how Scylla would probably have sounded. So it was a thrill to kind of feel you were there.
I'm Sally Wainwright, and I'm here for writing Happy Valley. Well, I'm delighted. Happy Valley's been a massive event for me. It's you know, I've written a lot of you know, reasonably successful shows before, but Happy Valley's really, the response to it has been really something else. So it's delightful to, you know, that people are recognising it in the way that they have done. Well, it was dark, but it also had a lot of humour in it, which is kind of why I wanted Sarah to play the central character, because I knew that she would get the depth and the warmth and the comedy as well. And I think that has been a large part of its success is, well, her, you know, that a lot of combination, a lot of factors have combined to make it what it was, but certainly her performance is something that people have talked about a huge amount, and deservedly so. You know, it was an extraordinary performance, but, you know, hopefully it was an extraordinary character as well. And but I think it's that combination of dark and warm, human, occasionally funny drama that appeals to people. I hope that's what it is. I don't, but, you know, there were a lot of factors. You know, I think we just got a lot of things right with the show, and it worked. I mean, one of the starting points was talking to Ben Stevenson at the BBC, and we're talking about shows we'd both liked in the past, and a big show that affected me when I was younger was Juliet Bravo, and I kind of, Happy Valley kind of became my modern version of Juliet Bravo, I suppose. There were other factors in play. I'd met an old friend, Lisa Farron, who's here today, who's a police officer, and Catherine kind of became based on Lisa. So that was another great factor that influenced me and helped me a lot, and helped me find the voice for Catherine and that kind of thing.
Obviously, I mean, you mentioned Sarah's an astonishing talent. What made her the right choice for the lead in this?
I think when we started filming Last Tango, the first series, I was just absolutely blown away by her performance. I knew she'd be good, but I think it's just shocked by how good she was. I don't know why I should be shocked by that, but she just seemed to bring so much to it. And I made quite a conscious decision that I really wanted to write something else for her, and that became Happy Valley.
Do you think that television writing gives people an opportunity to perhaps take risks that we don't see in feature films?
Yeah, because you can get things commissioned and shot and transmitted much more quickly. And I think I'm very lucky at the moment. The BBC have kind of given me enough rope to hang myself with, and they do let me kind of do what I want to a certain extent, and so you feel you can take risks. And I think when you take risks, it can pay off because it gives people confidence to express themselves. I hope much more truthfully and honestly. You're not trying to tick boxes. You're not trying to appeal to a certain group. You're just trying to write things that you hope will be entertaining, and that, you know, if it makes me laugh, or if I find it cathartic as I write it or whatever, I hope it will have that effect on the audience. So it allows you that confidence, I think. I'm just writing episode 4 of series 2 of Happy Valley at the moment. I've just finished writing a film about the Bronte sisters, and then a fourth series of Last Tango has been commissioned, but I'm not going to be able to write that for a while yet. So I don't think we finished telling the story. I felt we'd got a beginning, a middle and end with the first series, but I still think there were places to go with the story. You know, the story will go on, that Ryan will always be Tommy Lee Royce's son, and that's never going to go away for Catherine. So I'm exploring that further in the second series, as well as introducing new stories too. That's the big fear with following up the first series, is hoping that you found stories and situations that will have that same effect on the audience. I think we have. We've certainly found interesting stories. Whether we can achieve the same level of interest or not, I don't know. It's all looking very positive at the moment.
What does this award mean to you?
I was sort of gobsmacked when they told me they were going to give it to me. And I had to really think long and hard about this. I guess that this is about other stuff, really. Because when you're a turn and you just do some acting and some jokes, you don't get this stuff. It has to be to do with comic relief and the recent diversity work. And I think that because the diversity work has had an impact, and because comic relief has had such a big impact on our culture and in our lives, I think people are incredibly interested in what we're doing, and they follow the stories. So the diversity stuff particularly has really captured people's imagination, and the industry has got behind it in a way that perhaps they wouldn't have got behind it before. Just because I've been able to say some things because of who I am, and people have latched onto them. And as a result, since the BAFTA speech last year, there's been considerable movement. You know, quotas that we didn't ask for quotas because we think ring fence money is better, but quotas at Channel 4, BFI have worked out a diversity criteria. Channel 4 have worked out a system that perhaps punishes their producers if they don't meet diversity targets. BBC are doing initiatives and training, which they always do, but the difference here is that they're training executives. You know, this is very different. Executives, deputy commissioners, people who have the power to green light programs, this is a big deal, are being trained right now with leadership programs and things like that. So come here, Gogglebox people. Come in here. Sorry. Forget about that stuff. This is real diversity in action.
Oh my God.
Check it out.
Hello. Hi, Lenny. I've been watching Lenny from I was a baby.
I've been watching you.
He's so good. You look good, though.
The way you move yourself.
I didn't know you're so big.
Thank
you. Oh my God.
Look at you. Look at you. I'm sexy. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Is it nice for you to be here?
Yeah, it's thank nice you, to be here. You know, we're new celebrities, you know, on the block.
You know, he's got a microphone. You don't have to yell.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You can bring it down.
Yeah, yeah. Everything's nice, babes. You know what I mean? You get me, babes. All right? So, I'm just being myself. You get me?
Yeah, yeah. Be
new
yourself.
Celebrity on the block.
I love that.
Thank you very much.
Well, nice to see you.
All right.
All right, Lady.
Lady Henry, News at 10, Drury Lane.